Hello, children. We have already studied a disease which is caused by a protozoan, and the name of the disease was malaria. The causative organism was Plasmodium. We have studied in detail about the life cycle of the Plasmodium. Let us now study about another disease caused by a protozoan. The name of the disease is amoebic dysentery. The causative organism for the disease is Entamoeba histolytica. The mode of transmission. The disease is spread through contaminated food and water. If the food and water happens to be contaminated with the fecal material of the patient, there is a possibility of the disease spreading to a healthy person. So that is one way by which the disease spreads. The second method is house flies behave as carriers. They carry the pathogen from the feces of an infected person to the food. If defecation happens in an open place and if the feces contain the Entamoeba histolytica, the pathogen may be transferred from the feces to an open food, the food material which is kept open by the house flies. So these are the two methods by which the disease spreads from one person to another. Let us now discuss about the symptoms of the disease. The disease mainly causes abdominal cramps. Abdominal cramps means pain in the abdomen, and it is severe pain in the abdominal region. The second symptom is constipation. There is actually constipation alternating with diarrhea. So that's a typical symptom, constipation alternating with diarrhea. The third symptom is whenever there is diarrhea, the stools are tinged with mucus. Stools means feces. The fecal material is tinged with mucus and blood. Now, why is there mucus and blood in the fecal material? The reason is the pathogen, Entamoeba, produces a proteolytic enzyme. What do you mean by proteolytic enzyme? An enzyme which can destroy proteins. And I hope you can recollect that our GI tract is lined by cells made up of proteins and lipids. So the cell wall is definitely made of proteins and lipids, the cell membrane, sorry. So the proteolytic enzymes, cytolysine produced by the pathogen, erodes the mucus of the intestine. And when it erodes the mucus of the intestine, automatically small blood vessels are also ruptured, and hence mucus and blood is released out through the feces. So these are the typical symptoms of the disease caused by Entamoeba histolytica. The disease is amoebiasis. How do we prevent the disease? As we already know, prevention as well as mode of transmission is very much linked with each other. So the first way to prevent the disease is to avoid consuming contaminated food. Always ensure that the food material is kept in closed position, I mean covered, not exposed to the house flies. So always consume good fresh food which is not contaminated. And the second method is to drink boiled water. Drink boiled water are the two methods by which you can prevent the disease. Now, I'm sure all of you would recollect that we earlier learned that diseases are caused by pathogens, and the pathogens fall under several categories, starting with bacteria, virus, fungi, helminthus, as well as the protozoans. So these are the different categories by which diseases are caused. So let us now study about the next category of diseases, and those are the diseases caused by worms or helminth. The first disease is ascariasis. The name of the disease is ascariasis. How is it caused? The causative organism for the disease is Ascaris lumbricoides. The name of the causative organism is Ascaris lumbricoides, and the common name of this organism is roundworm. I'm sure all of you remember studying this in detail in your class 11. So Ascaris lumbricoides is the name of the causative organism. How is this disease spread? The disease is spread from one person to another through contaminated food and water. The same way as Entamoeba histolytica, here also the mode of transmission is through contaminated food and water. Let us study about the life cycle of the roundworm or Ascaris lumbricoides. The life cycle is said to be monogenetic. What is a monogenetic life cycle? We learned about a digenetic life cycle where there are two hosts. In the case of Plasmodium, the half of the cycle happens in human beings while the rest of the cycle happens in the female Anopheles mosquito. But this is known as monogenetic, meaning there is a single host. Two hosts are not there, one single host. It is in a single host that the life cycle is completed. So let's see how this life cycle proceeds. The adult female roundworm lives in the human intestine and it can produce as many as 2 million eggs per day, which is passed out of the feces. So you can imagine that the adult female roundworm, which lives in the human intestine, is producing so many eggs. And this feces, if it is deposited in a normal toilet, there is no possibility of the continuity of the life cycle. However, open defecation, when the feces is left in an open place, there are possibilities of the fecal material contaminating food like tubers, vegetables, leafy vegetables, certain fruits, etc. can be contaminated by the fecal material. Or if a person has faulty personal hygiene, meaning if a person does not wash his hands thoroughly after visiting the washroom, and that person is involved in cooking food, then in both these cases there is a possibility of the eggs which are released out through the feces entering into a new host. So that is how the eggs from one particular host enters into a new individual, to a new host, through the fecal material, through the contaminated food and water that is consumed by a healthy person. Let us see what happens in a new host. The eggs hatch into the juvenile form within the intestine. So a young worm hatches out from the egg in the fresh host, within the intestine of the fresh host. These eggs from the intestine enter into the bloodstream. They reach the bloodstream of the new host, and from the bloodstream reaches the liver, from where they migrate into the heart and then into the lungs. From the lungs, it literally crawls up the trachea, the bronchi and the trachea, and reaches the throat. From the throat, when it reaches the throat, there is a swallowing reflex which is created. All of us experience when there is something irritating in our throat, there is a swallowing reflex, and this reflex is created causing this juvenile worm to be swallowed back into the gastrointestinal tract of the new host. And when it enters into the gastrointestinal tract of the new host, automatically what happens is it has almost completed its migratory pathway and it has reached its final destination, which is the intestine, where it once again starts growing and becomes an adult. It completes its life cycle and it can start a fresh life cycle. Let us discuss some of the symptoms of ascariasis. The first symptom is the patient experiences fever. The second symptom is, as we saw, that the juvenile form passes from the intestine into the bloodstream. There is a chance for internal bleeding. And when there is internal bleeding, automatically there are possibilities of anemia. The third symptom is blockage of the intestine and colic pain. Now remember, there are possibilities of not one worm residing in the intestine, but there may be a large number of worms residing in the intestine, which may cause blockage of the intestine. And when the intestine is blocked, there is a possibility of colic pains. There are possibilities of muscle ache also. So these are the symptoms of the disease ascariasis. What is the prevention? Prevention is proper disposal of feces. As I said earlier, open defecation definitely causes, I mean not definitely, there are chances for the disease to spread. But if the feces is disposed in a proper toilet, there is less chance of the disease spreading from one person to another. The second preventive method is thorough washing of fruits and vegetables. The eggs of this particular worm may remain within the fruits or the vegetables, like the tubers, the carrot, the potato. And if such fruits and vegetables are thoroughly washed and cooked, then there is no chance of the disease spreading to a new host. Let us now study about the next disease caused by worms or helminths. The name of the disease is elephantiasis or filariasis. The causative organism of this disease is Wuchereria bancrofti, or there is another species, Wuchereria malai. Both these fall under the same genus, Wuchereria. Other than these two organisms, there is another genus called Brugia malai, commonly called as the filarial worm. In all these three cases, the common name for the causative organism is filarial worm. Let us now discuss about the mode of transmission. The mode of transmission is an infected female Culex mosquito. We have come across different types of mosquitoes like the Anopheles and the Aedes. Here we come across yet another species known as the Culex mosquito. So the mode of transmission for the disease filariasis is the female Culex mosquito. Let us now discuss about the life cycle of the filarial worm. The filarial worm is found living within the lymphatic vessels and the lymphatic ducts of the primary host, which is man. So it's a long thread-like worm living within the lymphatic system. The adult female worm is viviparous, meaning it does not lay eggs, but it delivers young ones, and these young ones are called as the microfilariae. These microfilariae, they exhibit day-night periodicity, meaning they are found during the daytime in the deeper blood vessels, but at night, that is basically between 8 p.m. and 4 a.m. they are found in the peripheral bloodstream, meaning close to the skin. Now you can obviously relate why they show this kind of periodicity. During the night time between 8 p.m. and 4 a.m. it corresponds with the blood sucking habit of the Culex mosquito, so that the microfilariae can now enter into the body of the mosquito during the night time. During the daytime, the Culex mosquito does not feed. So, the microfilariae are found in the deeper blood vessels, primarily of the lungs. So, that is why we call this as day-night periodicity. Now, let's see what happens. When the mosquito sucks blood, these microfilariae, they enter into the body of the mosquito. The mosquito is now called as the secondary host. Man is the primary host and the mosquito is the secondary host. When they enter into the mosquito's body, there is a very complicated life cycle which takes almost 10 days. And within these 10 days, the microfilariae, young ones, are converted or transformed into an infective stage. This infective stage within the mosquito migrate into the salivary gland in order to be transferred into a fresh host through the saliva. So basically you know that the pathogen is transmitted into a fresh host when a mosquito bites. So that is why the infective form remains in the salivary gland so that it can be transferred to a fresh host. Let us now discuss about the symptoms of the disease elephantiasis. The symptoms include enlarged lymph nodes and the lymph glands. You'll recollect that the adult worm lives in the lymphatic system. So definitely there is enlargement of the lymph nodes and the lymph glands. The second symptom is excessive edema. Edema is accumulation of fluids. Excessive edema and inflammation of the lower limbs. So the lower limbs or the legs are inflamed and it becomes huge and massive, just like that of an elephant's leg. That is the reason why it is known as elephantiasis. The third symptom is chronic enlargement of the lower limb and genital organs. Chronic means it is a long-lasting deformity. You find that there is initially the enlargement is small, but gradually it enlarges itself. As I said, it becomes as big as that of an elephant's leg. Not as, that is a bit of exaggeration, but it becomes massive in size. The genital organs are also deformed. If you check your textbook, you will find the picture of a patient suffering from elephantiasis. Now, what are the control measures? Definitely, the control measure would be eradicating the vector. Now, who is the vector? The vector was the female Anopheles mosquito. So, eradication of the mosquito is the most effective method for controlling this particular disease. Let me tell you that this particular disease is usually endemic. You find it localized to certain geographical areas where the population of Culex mosquito is surprisingly more. So, you find that in certain areas where the Culex mosquito is more, there is a proportional increase in the number of patients suffering from elephantiasis. Let us now study about the next category of the disease, that is the diseases caused by fungi. So this is the last category. We learned about the different types of diseases caused by different categories of pathogens. And this is the last category which you have to learn, that is fungi. And you have to learn just one disease. The name of the disease is known as ringworm. So don't get confused. Ringworm is not a worm, but it is a disease caused by a fungi. And it is not one single fungi which can cause this particular disease. The causative organism for ringworm fall under three genuses. It can either be the trichophyton or epidermophyton or the microsporum. Any of these three fungi can cause the disease named as ringworm. Let us now discuss about how the disease is transmitted or the mode of transmission. I wish to remind you that ringworm is one of the most common infectious disease. We have already learned what is an infectious disease, a disease which spreads from one person to another. And ringworm is a very common infectious disease, just like the common cold. And ringworm is also a contagious disease. What is a contagious disease? Which is spread through direct contact. So ringworm is a contagious infectious disease. So that's a mode of transmission. Now, mode of transmission, let us see how it is spread from one person to another. There are two different methods by which the disease is spread. One is when a person comes in contact with the soil containing the fungal spores. Suppose you do not walk with a proper footwear and you're walking in a contaminated area, a soil which is contaminated with the fungal spores. There are possibilities for the fungal spores to infect you, enter into your body through the skin. It doesn't enter into the body, actually it affects the skin, basically the skin, the epidermis. The second way by which the disease is transmitted is sharing of used articles of the patient. Suppose a patient or a person suffering from ringworm you use the towel or the dresses or the comb of an infected person. Normally this happens in, you know, places like hostels where you normally share. I mean, there's a common practice among children to share things, especially the comb or the dresses. When you use such things of an infected person, there are possibilities for the disease to spread from one person to another. So these are the two common methods by which the disease spreads from one person to another. Let us now discuss about the symptoms of the disease ringworm. What are the symptoms of the disease? The first symptom is dry, scaly lesions. Lesions means a diseased part, a diseased area of the skin. So you find dry, scaly lesions on the skin, scalp and the nail. So typically these lesions look like small circles. That is why it is known as, the disease is called as ringworm. So it appears to be scaly, small circular patches either on the skin or the scalp or at the base of the nails. The second symptom is there is intense itching at the affected region. Sometimes you find that infected person usually will be seen scratching his scalp or scratching the part of the skin which is affected, because there is intense itching that is created by the microsporum or the epidermophyton or the fungi at a particular affected region. The third symptom is usually this fungi can proliferate in the presence of moisture as well as warmth. So when there is warmth and moisture at a particular location in our body, that can increase the proliferation of the fungi. And this causes extreme proliferation of this fungi in the armpits, because you know armpit is a place where there is severe sweating, high sweating as well as there is moisture. So areas like the armpit, the groin as well as between the toes, these are three areas where there is maximum sweating and maximum temperature. So these are the three areas where fungal attack is found to be maximum. So these are the three typical symptoms of the disease ringworm. Prevention and control of infectious diseases. We have learned how each and every disease is prevented. I have already taught you, when I taught you about a particular disease, we learned how is it prevented. But let us just look at the general prevention and control of infectious diseases. The first one definitely is personal hygiene. If you keep yourself healthy, clean, and consume good food, food and water, then definitely we can keep away, a number of diseases can be kept away. So personal hygiene is very, very important. The second one is you also have to ensure that there is community hygiene. And for that, we have already discussed that there should be proper disposal of waste as well as fecal material. because through the fecal material there are possibilities for food material getting contaminated. So community hygiene is also very, very important. The third method is isolation of an infected person. Now typically, as you know, what is currently going on, the corona scare, the COVID disease, the most important method is to quarantine the person. If at all there is any symptom of the disease, isolation of the infected person is the most important way for preventing certain diseases like COVID, pneumonia, common cold, etc. The fourth method is to control the or eliminate vectors as well as their breeding places. As we know, many diseases are spread through mosquitoes, different types of mosquitoes, ranging from the Anopheles, the Culex, the dengue. We learned about all these mosquitoes and the diseases like filariasis, malaria, dengue, chikungunya, etc. So how do we control? We have already studied the different methods. Avoid stagnation of water, cleaning the household, coolers, because we have seen that many, indoor areas where there is water stagnation becomes a typical place where mosquitoes can breed. So small areas where there is chances for water to accumulate and stagnate should be cleaned in a regular manner and observing the dry day. Dry day means to clean up the entire premises before the onset of monsoon or in between the onset of monsoon. We have to keep everything in a dry manner. Use of mosquito nets as well as repellents. We have already studied that. The freshwater fishes like guppies and gambusias feed on the mosquito larvae. So that is a very effective method for controlling mosquito larvae, and we call that as biocontrol. The next method is spraying insecticides and of course using wire mesh mosquito nets on doors and windows. So this is again another way by which you can prevent or control infectious diseases. Vaccination. Now I am sure many of you have been vaccinated against a number of deadly diseases. Now our government of India provides an immunization schedule, and this immunization schedule is offered absolutely free, and that is the reason why we have, you know, very good methodology to control several diseases through a protocol of vaccination. Now I just briefly tell you certain vaccines and the diseases it prevents. BCG or Bacillus of Calmette and Guerin, that's a full form, Bacillus of Calmette and Guerin, it prevents tuberculosis. Now this is normally taken soon after birth, as soon as a child is born, before the child leaves the hospital. There is a small injection that is taken near the shoulder. All of you must have definitely taken it, and that particular disease prevents tuberculosis. You must have even read that the present COVID BCG vaccine has found to be, there was a report which says that BCG has found to be slightly effective in controlling the coronavirus, but I don't know how far this particular article is right or wrong. I think it is still under discussion. The second vaccine is DPT, diphtheria, pertussis and tetanus. DPT stands for diphtheria, pertussis and tetanus. Pertussis is whooping cough. Whooping cough. The name whooping cough is in Malayalam, it is known as villan chuma. So this vaccine prevents three diseases. OPV is another vaccine, and the full form is oral polio vaccine. Oral polio vaccine prevents the disease polio. Now you must have heard that pulse polio program where small children below the age of 5 are given oral drops, and that actually prevents the disease, a deadly, debilitating disease known as polio. And actually India is on the verge of eliminating polio from the society, but recently a couple of cases were reported. So polio is definitely given to all children. The next vaccine is MMR. MMR stands for measles, mumps and rubella. Rubella means German measles. So this again prevents three diseases. Hepatitis B. Hepatitis B is the name of the vaccine, and the disease it prevents is hepatitis B itself. And the last vaccine is HIB, Haemophilus influenza type B. You have already studied about influenza. So this particular vaccine prevents the disease Haemophilus influenza type B. So with this, we have learned about a large number of diseases caused by different types of pathogens. We have studied in detail about the mode of transmission and their symptoms. And now we conclude about how to prevent certain infectious diseases.